Welcome in, ladies and gentlemen, to the morning show. I have some breaking news for you guys. My flex predictions weren't that great. Neither were most of the running backs in week 9. Only two running backs scored above 20 points in my point scoring league. That was Dalvin Cook and Christian McCaffrey. So if you had J.D. McKissick, you probably had the RB3 on the week start for you. I started J.D. McKissick in quite a bit of leagues. He could play running back or wide receiver, and it was a bye week for the Bengals, and I have a lot of Tyler Boyd. So J.D. McKissick filled in nicely there. But yeah, it was not a good week overall for fantasy. Tom Brady laid a goose egg. Drew Locke had a great game. He was my QB start of the week. He was a QB5. He was not as profitable as Kyler Murray or Josh Allen, but he still performed well. He had a rushing touchdown. He had a couple passing touchdowns, 350 yards, I believe. He performed well. I said Teddy Bridgewater was a sit, and that was a completely wrong call. This dude put his team on his back. He rushed for first downs on fourth downs. He's a good quarterback, but he still is not what I think is the answer for Carolina long term. So we'll see for dynasty purposes what it's Teddy worth in the offseason, what they do in the offseason. But it's nearing the end of the half. It's the second half of the season now. If you need a quarterback and you need one badly, Teddy Bridgewater could be a name to trade for because he's not going to be as expensive as the other ones. So as I continue on, I'll talk about quarterbacks this week. Kyler Murray, Josh Allen, QB1 and 2. Depending on your league scoring, Kyler Murray was the QB1 again. This dude just had his bye week, and he's like top. He was a QB3 coming out of the bye week. He's probably going to be the QB1 now. Patrick Mahomes right behind them at 3. He had a good week again, but he's going to be on bye next week. So good luck, Patrick Mahomes owners, if you need a quarterback. Coming in at number 4 is Aaron Rodgers on Thursday Night Football. He played a banged-up San Francisco team. San Francisco obviously was no match for the Green Bay Packers. Green Bay steamrolled them. Davante Adams or Marquez Valdes-Scantling. If you had them and you didn't play Marquez Valdes-Scantling, I feel sorry for you. He's on your bench with a lot of points. He's probably on most people's benches with a lot of points, though, so don't fret it, man. Just you live and you learn. You start your studs. That's the truth of fantasy. You start your studs. And coming in at QB7 was Ben Roethlisberger in my leagues. Ben Roethlisberger had a good week against a bad Dallas defense. He completely destroyed them. Not really, but he completely ripped their defense apart. They won the game. Garrett Gilbert almost led a comeback. Speaking of Garrett Gilbert, he was a QB20 on the week. That's pretty good for a Dallas quarterback, man. Speaking of nowadays, Dallas has struggled to find a quarterback, and Garrett Gilbert's scoring about 18.95 points in a 6-point passing touchdown league is pretty good. And then we'll go to Tua. Tua was the QB15 of the week. That was a good performance by Tua. He put up some good numbers. He looked good. You know, he's going to be a serviceable quarterback for you in the future. Not sure if he's going to be a QB1. We'll see with him. He has a lot of room to grow. And right behind Tua was another rookie quarterback. And no, you probably don't know his name. It's Jake Luton. He had 26.5 points in my league. That's a substantial amount of points for quarterbacks, considering Lamar Jackson only had 20.3 in my league. Jake Luton led he tried to lead a game-tying drive, and they failed the 2-point conversion. So it was awesome to see a quarterback step in, similar to how Gardner Minshew did, and elevate his team. And DJ Chark was a big benefactor there. I had DJ Chark as a sit this week. Man, was I wrong. I was so wrong there. DJ Chark was the wide receiver for in my leagues, scoring 27.6 fantasy points. He did really well this week. He got the deep shots he needed, he got the targets he needed, and he looked better. Keelan Cole didn't get as many targets, thankfully, so, you know, DJ Chark popped off. Another name that I had on my sit list was Curtis Samuel. I said, don't expect him to do it again. Well, guess what he did? He did it again, man. 26.8 points in my fantasy leagues. He was around 23 to 26, depending on your league scoring. He did really well for himself, wide receiver 5. If this continues, man, Curtis Samuel's become a start consistently. What happened to DJ Moore? We don't know. DJ Moore's gone. He's dead to Teddy Two Gloves, clearly. He's gone in the wind, though, man. it's been rough for us DJ Moore owners, because I am a big owner of DJ Moore. I have a lot of belief in his talent, and it's sad to see him get restricted by this coaching regime and Teddy Bridgewater. So hopefully against Tampa Bay, he can have a breakout game again. He did well against Tampa Bay in week three, I believe. So we'll see. But I want to talk about Terry McLaurin. Terry McLaurin, for me, has cemented himself as a wide receiver 10 for my personal dynasty rankings. He's in the top 10. I'm not going to name them all off for you guys. But Terry McLaurin has reached the top 10 for me in dynasty wide receiver assets. He has consistently been good. He did it with Alex Smith at quarterback. He did it with Kyle Allen at quarterback. He did it with Dwayne Haskins at quarterback. He's just really good, man. It doesn't matter who's throwing it to him. He's going to beat his corners. And right behind Terry this week was DK Metcalf in my leagues. DK Metcalf had a great week, man. He is continuing to produce, besides that one week where he only had 2 points and he ran down Buda Baker. That was probably his most impressive play of the year. But DK Metcalf came back and had a strong showing in a loss. Christian Kirk was a top 10 wide receiver. And, you know, this is surprising as well, because at the beginning of the season, our Patreon group chat, patreon.com/dynastywarzone, I said that Christian Kirk could have a Chris Godwin type year where Chris Godwin had broken out. I regress on that statement, digress on it, and I think that Christian Kirk is not Chris Godwin, but he might be Will Fuller. He might be the best baller, you know? He has been consistently putting up deep shots. If they hit, he scores. It's been nice to see. And then nice to see as well was Juju Smith-Schuster. Juju Smith-Schuster was the wide receiver 11. All the Pittsburgh wide receivers scored pretty well this week because they all reached the top 24, I believe. No, top 30 in my leagues. Deontay Johnson still broke double digits. Chase Claypool broke double digits. And Juju Smith-Schuster broke double digits. So, you know, if you started them, you had a pretty good week, most likely. It's been nice having Steelers wide receivers on my team. They're plug and play guys if you need them. It's been great for fantasy production to see Deontay Johnson actually play a game. Chase Claypool producing with Deontay Johnson out there is nice to see, and Juju producing as well is nice to see. Coming at the wide receiver 12 was Will Fuller. Will Fuller had himself a nice touchdown grab. Really saved the day for him. I'm glad they did not trade him from the Houston Texans. I would be beside myself if they did, because that's the only weapon that Deshaun Watson has. And he has been consistent this year. He's been healthy for the most part, besides that hamstring injury. And he is scoring well. So I like Will Fuller a lot. He's a good buy low right now. You could probably get him for a cheaper price than you would for Stephon Diggs or Juju Smith-Schuster, or even maybe he's around probably Christian Kirk in value right now, because Christian Kirk is blowing up in value. And then finishing as a wide receiver two this week, but still scoring a considerable amount of points, was A.J. Brown. A.J. Brown is a top 10 dynasty asset. He's continued to prove that. He did that against Chicago's secondary, which is considerably better than most NFL secondaries. He's a good player. He's a baller, man. A.J. Brown is a name to have on your dynasty teams. He had 20.1 points in my fantasy league. And, you know, I drafted him. He's consistently been my favorite wide receiver to own. And, man, was I wrong on him coming out, because I was not very high on A.J. Brown. But, you know, in startups, I've been taking him everywhere I can recently. In a midseason startup, I just took him in the third round, and it felt like a steal. Going on. The wide receiver 16, Marquez Valdes-Scantling, your bench player, man. We've touched on it already. He was probably on your bench, but he had a good week. 19.3 points. You know, that's decent for a wide receiver. He was a wide receiver 16, so wide receivers really popped off this week, where the running backs did not. And it was a rough week for running backs, and I'm going to touch on that in a second. But I just wanted to get on one more name on the wide receivers, and that is Robbie Anderson. Robbie Anderson only has one touchdown on the year, but he's been consistently a wide receiver one or two for you. So, you know, he's going to get you yards. You know he's going to get yards. So just continue to start him. He's playing for his old college coach, Matt Rhule. Matt Rhule loves Temple players, I guess. So Robbie Anderson's going to continue to get this production, I guess. We'll see. But, you know, Robbie Anderson, Sideshow Bob, he's been awesome. I continue to start him with confidence. And just one more name. Gabriel Davis stole away Michael Beasley targets. Gabriel Davis had himself a day for a rookie. Looked good. Did some stuff in the red zone. You know, he is a polarizing prospect coming out of UCF. He was a good athlete. And, you know, he compared himself to Odell Beckham Jr. He wears the arm sleeve. He wears the number. Go get yourself some Gabriel Davis before his value shoots up in price, you know? Moving on to running backs. Like I said, if you didn't have Dalvin Cook or Christian McCaffrey, you probably didn't score that well this week. The RB5 was Alvin Kamara. He had 15.9 points in my fantasy leagues. But the RB4 was Kalen Ballage. And somehow he's now on the Chargers and he's getting snaps. Who would have predicted that at the beginning of the year? Not me. That's pretty funny to see Kalen Ballage crack the top 10, top 5 for running backs. When everyone knocked his vision, everyone knocked him coming out of college. I knocked him. And, you know, he's bounced around, and that's shown that he hasn't been able to find his place, but maybe now he's found some traction in the NFL to where he can continue to get some snaps on this Chargers team. Justin Jackson went out of the game early, I think, with an injury. I'm not sure. I'll have to look that up. But Kalen Ballage stepped up and produced against the porous Oakland Raiders. He has Miami next. Miami's a good team. Good run defense. Might be hard for him to run on them. I would be wary of starting him. Look for a better option. Moving on, James Robinson continues to be an RB1, putting up 15.9 points in my league. He was the RB6, tied with Alvin Kamara. He is still good, guys. You know, without Gardner Minshew, he's still good. He's still producing. Jake Luton helped him, man. It was a decent week for him. And speaking of a decent week, I said David Johnson was a start for running backs, and it turned out to be Duke Johnson that was a start. Duke Johnson put up a RB1 stat line. Not saying that much this week because the RBs didn't really produce that much, but he did really well for what he was given. And then Wayne Gallman came in as the RB9 in my leagues, and Wayne Gallman's been a great add, man. He's a league winner. Coming out of Clemson, he had the talent to be a starting running back in the NFL, and then they drafted Barkley, and he got kind of buried on the depth chart, but now he's been able to show his stuff, and he's got it, man. He looks nice. He looks like a running back. He looks like a NFL running back on the field, can catch the ball, he can go between the tackles, he can do everything you need him to do, so Wayne Gallman could have some future value to him. We don't know what is going to happen with him. He could leave New York, could find a new team. I like Wayne Gallman quite a bit going forward. Could be a good buy for like a third or a fourth round pick if the owner would give him up for that little. he's polarizing, man. Seeing him come in with an RB1 finish is nice. I say RB1 as in an RB top 12 finish. And Josh Jacobs finally had a good finish. You know, I didn't think Josh Jacobs would have a good week. He finished the RB10. Not saying that much this week again because a lot of running backs finished within that range of values, as in like Zach Moss, DeAndre Swift, Antonio Gibson, Clyde Edwards-Helaire all finished close to him. Devontae Booker of the Oakland Raiders finished close to him. Aaron Jones finished close to him. Ryan Nall of the Chicago running backs, he looks like a fullback. He finished as an RB12, so, you know, they all finished close in value to Josh Jacobs. And I want to say sorry for saying Todd Gurley was a sit. You know, he was the RB11 of the week. He had a good performance. You know, he's not the same running back on the Rams, but he didn't look bad, man. He had a good week against a good run defense in the Denver Broncos. Did okay and found production. And that's something you want to see out of someone like Todd Gurley, especially since he's been knocked for his knees. He had a good performance. And I want to say I'm sorry to Zach Moss. Zach Moss is doing a lot better now. I called him Zach Doodoo Moss at the beginning of the year because he was not going to do well. I was wrong. He put up a RB15 stat line, finishing right above my man DeAndre Swift. He had the opportunity. He produced. He did enough to get fantasy relevance this week. And he was right around DeAndre Swift and Antonio Gibson in points. And Antonio Gibson, he had a fumble on a long run that really set him back this week. JD McKissick got a little more snaps because of it. Antonio Gibson's a name to trust in the long run, though, man. He's got all the talent. He can he can do two consecutive jukes in a row, which is something that's rare for running backs. That's just insane athleticism for, especially at his weight and height speed. Like, his speed score is insane for his weight and height, is what I'm trying to say. And he's got the Detroit Lions defense next, which is not great, man. Detroit Lions are not a very good running defense. So expect him to produce again next week. So we'll see. We'll see Antonio Gibson continue to rise in value in dynasty leagues. He is not going to be someone you want to buy right now, but if you have him, you're not going to want to sell him right now. So continue to hold him. He's been great. He's been an awesome second or third round pick, depending on where you got him in your rookie drafts. And just watch him blow up against my Detroit Lions, who are just terrible. They are just awful. Clyde Edwards-Helaire finishing as a running back too. He's on a bye week next week. It's unfortunate that he's not been getting more red zone work, but he finally got his touchdown. It was, I think, a receiving touchdown, and he scored right above DJ Dallas, who's a name that I had similar in my rankings. It was kind of a toss-up who do you play between them, and I was like, I'll play Clyde Edwards-Helaire over DJ Dallas, and it kind of worked out because, you know, 0.5 points is half a point, so what's the difference, really? And Chase Edmonds finishing as an RB20. He had a lot of opportunity. Didn't really produce. He didn't get a touchdown, but he had yards. So, you know, Chase Edmonds could be a name to watch and buy right now. He could be a good buy low because he did not produce that much in a good matchup where Kyler Murray just balled out. So you could buy probably some Chase Edmonds for pretty cheap. And then Tyler Irvin had a good finish. I was so down on Tyler Irvin. And, man, he stepped in when Aaron Jones was out, and he produced in the receiving game. He was a decent running back, not someone I'd want long-term. But, yeah, he had an RB2 finish, and I was wrong on him. I was on the Dynasty Rewind, and I said he'd have under 2-point-something fantasy points. Man, he had 11. So I did a drinking bet for them. I did a shot. I'm going to do some shots on the flex cast because I was wrong on some of the flexes the week. So expect that later in the week, probably on Friday with Dr. Kyle. I'll be doing some drinks. It'll be fun. It'll be a fun time. And speaking about fun times, if you had Justin Herbert, he continues to put up great numbers. So, yeah, Justin Herbert's a QB1 now. He's just got in a redraft, in a dynasty league that startup that we just did. He was the QB4, I believe, drafted as a QB4. So that's very high. He went before Lamar Jackson. He went before Deshaun Watson. He's just been a baller this year. No one can really stop his arm talent. He's going to continue to put up godly numbers. He might be someone, if you have two quarterbacks already, that you look to sell. Because he has a very hot value right now. I like to sell when the value's hot. But, you know, this is a young rookie stud. If your quarterback's like Matt Ryan, go sell Matt Ryan instead. Do not sell Justin Herbert. If you have Deshaun Watson and like Kyler Murray, or Josh Allen and Kyler Murray, and then you have Justin Herbert on your bench, what is Justin Herbert going to do for you that, you know, Stephon Diggs and a pick or something wouldn't do for you instead? So, yeah, it was a good week for quarterbacks. It was a good week for wide receivers. Ugly week for running backs. And then at tight end, you had my man TJ Hockenson finishing as tight end 5. He's the tight end 3 in the year in PPR leagues, I believe. Maybe the tight end 2. He is a tight end top 3 in Dynasty for me in value. This man continues to produce, and he's going to continue to produce. He has Washington next. He's going to have a good game as long as Stafford plays. Stafford cleared the concussion protocol, so he should be playing. Expect TJ Hockenson to continue to produce, man. This guy is a top asset on the Lions. He's great. I love TJ Hockenson. I have him in almost every league I'm in. And then Travis Kelce putting up 39.9 points in our Dynasty League for the Patreons. That's a lot of points. I don't think he scored a touchdown, and that's a lot of points. That's just a lot of yards. He's continuing to show that he can do it at his age. He's not going to go away anytime soon. Travis Kelce's going to win you leagues this year, guys. And surprisingly, Jimmy Graham finishes the tight end, too, this week. He had a nice touchdown grab between two defenders. Makes sense that he finished that high. And yeah, Irv Smith, breakout game against the Detroit Lions. Is it really a breakout game when you play the Lions? Though we'll see next week when he plays the Chicago Bears at the Chicago Bears. They have a good linebacking core. We'll see if the play-action pass can get open for Irv Smith Jr. I really like Irv Smith going forward. And then Adam Trautman. Adam Trautman finishes the tight end 9. Who expected that? Not me. He had a great grab as against the Buccaneers. He has the San Francisco 49ers up next. He's the tight end 2 on his team as well, so don't expect him to continue to produce these numbers, but he could be a good buy right now. He's a great stash if you have him. I would hold him. Expect him to be a cornerstone of this roster in the future. You know, he's going to be a valuable tight end asset. He was the best 3-cone at the combine, and he was a tight end. So that shows he's a very athletic tight end. And just wait for him to get groomed into the tight end 1 in there, because Jared Cook will not be there for that long. So, yeah, with that, I hope y'all have a great week. I'll see you on Friday for the FlexCast, and I'm signing off.